Coach, I know last week you said you had to throw up basically the scouting report for Tulane. Is it the same with Kentucky?
Yeah, for sure. I think 2 months or month and a half in college baseball is an eternity. For young people, I think it's an eternity. So starting over from scratch, and you know, they played 5 games last weekend, and so that was a little bit of a benefit for us to be able to see kind of where all their guys are at. The style of their team hasn't changed very much in terms of they have a really good identity. They know what it is. They play to it. They pitch to it, and it's going to be a great challenge.
How difficult is it to be a shortstop, and how would you compare Jordan's body of work this year to that of last year?
I think it's you could go tied for first most difficult position on the field with catcher, and most important position along with catcher. He's done a great job. He's had an outstanding season. His physical skills are elite in terms of his range, his arm strength. His game awareness has really improved this year, and really proud of him.
Just what Skeens delivered, and it looks so effortless and like really not violent at all, yet he throws 101, 102. Just what goes into how effortless the delivery of his pitches are?
Yeah, I think he's done a great job with his strength and conditioning. He's done a great job with his recovery. I think the one benefit that we got by eliminating the hitting is it took away a lot of rotations that he was having, swinging the bat. And when you're a right-handed pitcher, right-handed hitter, you're rotating essentially the same way. So taking some of that workload off of his body, I think has really, really helped him. As far as rest, recovery, an opportunity to feel better more consistently, and he's taken full advantage of that.
You're very attention to detail. You haven't had any problems with your guys. There was a controversial ejection the other day. An outfielder came in, said some things, was thrown out. Are those the kind of things you have to bring up as far as chippiness and let's stay away from that kind of stuff?
In our game, there was?
No.
Clemson, Tennessee, another regional.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I think, self-discipline, control of yourself is really important. I think, something I've said to them is you can't control your performance unless you can control yourself, I think. So having self-control is super important. And anytime they exhibit it in a good way, we always try to highlight that and bring those to the table as examples, so that people see them. And you're never going to be perfect. So when somebody gets outside themselves in that regard, we try to address it so we learn from it. And this is a mature team, and have done a good job with that for the most part this year.
You talk a lot about the team's ability to snap back or correct back after either losses, mistakes, play appearances, those kinds of things. Is that one of the main reasons why you guys have been as successful?
Yeah, I think so. I think I said this in some way last weekend, success is really never final, unless you win the last game, and failure is never fatal unless you let it be. And in the course of a baseball game, there's no clock in baseball, so you can't overcome. But what you see a lot of times is young players will have a harder time staying in the moment, and they'll carry that failure with them. And then, maybe a bad play or a bad at bat beats them 2 or 3 times instead of just the one time. And so if you have the mental discipline or disposition to move on to the next thing, that's a really powerful tool. And these guys have done a really good job of that between, plays in a game, between games, between weekends, all year long.
Who do you go to, guys, for weather? I mean, the weather advisor. Who do you go to? Do you have a meteorologist? Who do you go to?
Who's the underground coach?
I don't even know what that means. I don't even know why I said that. Literally, I said that. I have no idea what that means. We just do our due diligence. Everybody on the staff has every weather app possible. We have connections, probably some of your colleagues if you work at news stations. I heard some interview from Nick Saban one time says he watches the Weather Channel every morning, so I thought if that's going to help me win, I'll just throw on the Weather Channel every morning. There's a lot of people involved in that.
How do you approach that, though, seriously, because you're in that same situation again this week?
Well, I mean,
pitching-wise.
it was very good for a lot of reasons that we were able to win the regional, and we have a really good tournament rep here, Greg Seitz, and he was here last weekend as well. And I was able to go to him afterwards on Monday and just like, hey, like this worked out for us, but like we can't start a game like we did on Sunday and then have that happen. Now, nobody's perfect, and I get there's pop-ups and this and that, but like there's too much on the line, and you have to be really diligent in doing what's best for the players, not just for their safety, that's the first and foremost importance, but for the integrity of the game. And that's super important, and I'm pretty sure Coach Mangione would tell you the same thing.
Do openers factor into this at all?
I'm sorry?
Do openers, does that idea kind of give you
a we're going to watch it all the way up till game time. We will not start the game unless we have a window to play the game.
Coach, bouncing back to your last point there, obviously meeting your conference opponent, but meeting them too, does that have any advantage at this moment, or is it a fresh slate?
You know, I don't think so. You know, baseball, and this is not a new statement from me, it's not always the team with the best players, it's the team that plays the best that day. You know, fortunately for us, we've had good players that have played great more often than they haven't this year. So we've just always tried to keep it more about ourselves and what we need to do to execute. And then with that being said, be aware of what makes the other team successful and try to be disruptive, you know, to that. And so I'll be honest, I haven't even really thought about the series in April a whole lot, just because so much time has passed for both them and us. And you know, there's certain things you can take away that we did, but it's two probably different teams than we're playing here in April.
Does your pitching get set up differently knowing that you're not guaranteed a third game in this scenario?
You know, I just, playoff baseball is playoff baseball, and it's usually just a all hands on deck mentality for the game in front of you. And you know, the regionals are that way, this weekend's that way, Omaha's that way, you get to the finals, it's that way. So yeah, I'd probably say so. It's definitely different than a 2 out of 3 regular season series.
Television dictates a lot, right? The 2 o'clock start, there's no moving up to noon or any of that stuff, right? I mean, you're locked into that.
Yes, yes and no, but again, it's like the game has to be played in a atmosphere that's fair, you know. I mean, so much so that we're playing on our home field, but in the second game we'll be the visiting team, you know. So if we're going to go to those measures, then, you know, we should do everything we can, whether it's weather, those types of things. I mean, I played a super regional game where the lights went out in the stadium when I had a guy throwing a one-hit shutout in the sixth inning, and it was 1-0. You know, so we're going to try to stay away from those types of things.
You can't move it up, though, right? You can only move it back.
I don't believe we can move it up. Yeah. I don't know. We're having our administrative meeting at 3 o'clock today, and I'm sure that's something they'll address.
Coach, if there's rain in the area, I mean, how do you, is it vague, or can you, how do you be specific on something like that?
Well, there's a lot of people working on it, meaning from the NCAA, not just LSU or Kentucky. There's a games committee. There's coaches, and it, well, obviously we both want to win, you know, in a competitive element. But I think there's enough smart people that will make really, really good decisions as far as that goes. Now, if I'm not, I could be, the days have all run together, but Monday there was no chance we were going to be able to play, and we completed all 9 innings. So it's weather in South Louisiana in June, which I had no idea about before I got here.
you and Nick have a unique relationship. Kind of talk about that, yeah. I guess, and having faced each other before, probably not with his stakes, I assume.
Well, no, we did. In 2016, he was an assistant at Mississippi State when we beat them in the Super Regionals. He's one of my best friends in coaching. You know, there's probably 4 or 5 scores on D1 baseball that you look at first when your game's over every day that you hope wins. He's definitely one of those. Been friends for a long time, you know, coached in the NAI World Series against each other in 2004. Worked some camps together. You know, a lot of similarities in coaching and style, and you know, really really good friend, you know, so very happy for him and their team, and the success that they've had this season. And I mean, it's no question that who we want to be successful this weekend is not anybody wearing blue.
On Wednesday, Coach, you said that Kentucky's not like any other team in the SEC. Mm-hmm. Why is that, and what makes them so hard to play?
Yeah, they've done a really good job recruiting this team and this roster. They built a very beautiful ballpark where it's cold for most of the year. It's big and it's turf. Those things lend themselves to defense and creating runs in a different way. And so they've kind of recruited to their park, to the climate they live in, all of those things. So it becomes a very strike zone discipline, bunting game, running game, apply pressure to the defense. And I think they've done a good job matching the model of their school and the players that they can get with their park. And then more importantly, they've coached it very, very well. And then on the pitching side of it, you know, you see a lot of guys that ride the ball up at the top of the zone in the SEC, where they have guys that sinker, slider you to death and try to get them to hit the ball on the ground on that turf. And so, you know, you have to be really deliberate in your plan and have to be very disciplined in your plan of how you're going to defend their style and take at bats against their style. But they do a really good job of what they do.
Kind of like Jared Jones has had a huge year for a true freshman, hadn't played as much lately. What job do you guys do as the coaching staff? Hey, your big moment could be coming at any time.
Well, we at LSU, we coach every player in the program. You know, so let's call Dylan Cruz Tiger number one. There's a Tiger number 40, and that player gets coached really, really hard and well too. And when you got a guy like Jared, I mean, we're not in this situation without Jared. I mean, you think about, hit a couple home runs in the Sunday game against Kentucky, that we won the game 7-6, and he had a great freshman season. There's guys all over the league that have a lot of talent that didn't do a quarter of what Jared has done this year. So he's been working, got a start in Hoover in the SEC tournament. He's all about the team. I mean, I sat down with him on Monday and had a good talk and good meeting with him. And there's a pathway for him to affect these games this weekend. And if we were to go to Omaha, the same there. And what a luxury, you know, for us, you know, to have him and a couple guys on the bench that have contributed to this team being here. That's a good thing for us, and he's done a great job of not just accepting his role, but embracing his role and executing it. And so I don't think we've seen or heard the last of him for this year.
Paul has had such an exceptional year. What are you most pleased about it and for him?
Well, pleased about it is reliability. You know, I think about 20 whatever years of doing this. I mean, I've never had a pitcher like that, where you know what you're going to get. And it really helps and simplifies some decisions within a game and within a weekend, because as you saw last weekend, his performance can not only win the game he pitches, it can really positively affect the next game or the weekend. You know, as far as for him, I mean, he's created tremendous value for himself here and has done it in a way with as dominant as he could be to positively impact this team, this program. And on the backside of this, you know, you'll see him in the major leagues a lot sooner than later. And, you know, as far as the person side, it's well documented. I mean, he's the leader of our team. I mean, so to spend 11 months here and be the leader of a team of a program of this magnitude, that tells you all you need to know.
He's added a lot of weight since he's come here. And when I say weight, I mean,
I think it's helped him tremendously. I think the maturity and the approach of preparation, which we've talked about a lot, I think, again, moving away from the two-way thing, he's also burning a lot of calories trying to be a catcher and swing and run the bases and all that type of stuff, where he's not doing that now. So I think that's helped add to the weight. I think Derek Groomer, our strength coach, has done a really good job with him between the, we'll just call it Fridays, because he pitched on Friday most of the time. You know, the nutrition part of it, you know, I remember this road trip, like I walked back to go to the bathroom and I was walking back to my seat and I mean, these notes that were being written, handwritten, like perfect handwriting, and he had like this like video he was watching, which was obviously a high level thing about mindset and preparation. There's no area that he's not like fully invested in to help him be really, really good. And so when you have talent and then you have that, you have Paul Skeens, you know, best pitcher on the planet right now.
Last time you guys faced Kentucky, there was a pretty good amount of trash talk going back and forth in that series. Is that something that's sort of in the back of your guys' head at all heading into this series at all, or not really?
You know, I don't even remember that, to be honest with you. So it's not in mine. Again, I think when you look at this weekend, there's a whole lot more, I think, on our players' mind than, you know, what somebody may have said about them. You know, they want to execute for us, like the opponent. I don't want to speak for them, but I don't think the opponent really matters. If it was the Yankees or Kentucky, you know, their job remains the same, and they've shown some discipline to be able to not get off track. But, you know, thanks for the heads up on that. You know, we'll watch for that. If
you're glad the MLB draft has been pushed back a little bit, so a guy like Skeens and Curtis, who you know is going to be for top five, that kind of stuff's not being thought of at this moment?
Yeah, I mean, yes. I'll never forget, I was the same when we coached against each other in 16. We were at Mississippi State. We won a 11-inning game to go to Omaha. I mean, I was just in disbelief, like, all, you know, all these years going to Omaha finally. And the draft was going on that day. So we had, like, players that had gotten drafted that it's like, man, I better circle back with them and congratulated them. And then, like, we had six recruits that went in the draft. And I was like, yeah, so much for enjoying your first trip to Omaha. I got to get on the phone and do some work. But I think it's good. They can be present here. And then at that time, which is a lifelong goal for them, they can be present there, too. Oh yeah, like there are no bad days at that place. There are no bad days at that place.
Do you remember the road trip it was with Skeens? I mean, there's a lot of them, so remember them together. But do you remember which one it was that you went to the bathroom with Skeens?
It was recent, so it was either on the bus back from the SEC tournament, or I think it was maybe when we were leaving Georgia going to the SEC tournament. So it was very recent.
You talked about how much you enjoy preparing when it's a super as opposed to a regional. You could have played five, most of you can play three. As far as the pitching, is it more of a go for it type approach with the guys and put them in their lanes, as you like to say?
Yeah, I mean, that's in a regional, you're doing it that way as well. It's just the only difference is you're playing a different team each day, possibly. But yeah, I mean, we have a pretty good idea 16 weeks into it now of who's what and who's what today and how that fits with what we want to try to do this weekend. So feel good about that. And, you know, we're going to meet here shortly and really pin that down again.
How do you think the freshmen have sort of handled this entire season now heading into this postseason run? Like, how much have they grown, I guess?
Tremendously. I mean, I actually met with four of them on Monday. You know, my hope and work will be we're in a similar spot next year, largely because of how those guys improve. And when you look at the contributions some of them have made, you know, Gavin here recently on the mound, you know, Jared throughout the year at the plate, Paxton throughout the year, executing whatever role we've given him. Brady, until he got hurt, you know, was a starter. We've probably played more freshmen than any team in the SEC for sure this year that have contributed on a team that's really, really good. You know, and then they want to be a part of something special, and we've had great leadership from the older guys. So as some of their maybe responsibilities have changed a little bit down the stretch, they've handled that with a lot of class and maturity, and everybody's all about the team. And there's going to come a time next year when, you know, Paxton Kling's leading off and Jared Jones is hitting third or fourth, and Brady Neal's, you know, hitting second or fifth, and that they're going to have to grab a younger player and remember how they were mentored by Paul Skeens, Dylan Cruz, Gavin Dugas, Cade Beloso, and then pass that along or pay it forward. So it's honestly been one of the most awesome dynamics about this group.
Did you have to kind of persuade Hayden Travinsky to come back this year? Was there a conversation about that?
Yeah, there was. And understand, you know what I mean? Like, he's a talented guy. Unfortunately, he was hurt. Like, he missed the entire fall with the meniscus tear. He wasn't even really ready to play when the season started. Kind of forced his way into it and then played a lot. I mean, he was playing a lot in the middle of SEC play, and then he got a concussion and then got beat up. So we had some conversations about, what do you think? You know, I flew up to the Cape Cod League last summer and spent a day with him and spent a day with Jordan to make sure we were all dialed in, and talked about the plan for this thing. And, you know, and then he got hurt again and missed most of the fall. And I just, how he handled it from that point forward was phenomenal, and really excited to see his success. And not very many people playing better baseball than him right now.
In what ways did you see him, like, working while he was waiting for his opportunity?
Yeah, just he was super engaged with the team and pitchers in terms of catching bullpens, talking to them. Great dugout guy within the game. Anytime I asked him to get ready to pinch hit or do something, it was never like, hey, I wish I was playing more, bad attitude. But no, none of that. It was the opposite. And then in batting practice, like, the swing was simplifying, tightening up. He's always had strength, but it's like, hey man, that looks a lot closer to translating in the game. And he deserves a lot of credit for that. Him and Coach Wanaka kept working. And then the right time just started to appear for pinch hits. And then when Brady went down, it's like, well, we're in a bad way catching wise. So you couldn't catch either of them all the time. And so then those opportunities started to come, and I mean, the rest is history.
Did you see anything in the pass balls? Was it just fatigue?
On Monday? Yeah, there was a couple that were pitcher-related, pitch-related, and a couple where maybe he was leveraging his energy with a 9-run lead, you know. So, yeah.
A lot of these guys have been just willing, and when asked to move to a different spot or wherever it may be that you've asked of them, they've done it. Can you say that's something that's really helped you as a coach this season?
Oh, 1,000%. And we talked about it here. It's like, if you want to do something great, you know, emulate people that have been great. And so I took the national championship teams here, and we found stories of guys that, you know, cared more about the team than getting theirs, so to speak. And then we just outlined that, and it's just like, if you can emulate this, then we can be pretty good. And I don't know if we're gonna do what those teams did, but they've done the same types of things that those teams did to put us in a really good spot. And as a coach, that definitely makes you proud.
Well, then, Cedric Harris was here.
Yeah.
Today. He says he's gotten to know you a bit.
Yeah.
And everything.
Yeah.
Well, just your thoughts on him and some of those guys that come around.
Yeah, Hall of Fame person. Earlier on, he spent some time with our team and talked to our team. Great message. Great. Obviously, was a great player. Better human being. Invested in the program. One of those guys that, you win a big game, you know, in the SEC, he's one of the first texts you get. And that's awesome, you know, as a coach, to have guys that were that player, that are that impactful, that are great role models, you know, to get them to spend time with our players and care about LSU still is pretty awesome.
Yeah.